So yeah, as Sienna mentioned, I work on climate breakdown. I'm based at the University of Warwick, where I've been for a number of years, and I teach on a program entitled Global Sustainable Development. And one of the courses that I teach looks at the social dimension of sustainability. So it's an often neglected aspect. We often think about sustainability in terms of its environmental features, so the geophysical effects that are taking place as part of climate breakdown, for instance. Or we might also think about sustainability in terms of economic sustainability. But what I try and bring a focus on is the more sort of social and political aspects of sustainability. And I'll say a little bit about some of my research and some of my findings in relation to how climate breakdown is unfolding in the Caribbean, to try and to make the point that we can't understand climate breakdown without thinking socially and politically. And I hope that that will lead into some of what I have to say about the second theme of militarization. So from working on the Caribbean, actually before I start on the Caribbean, I just wanted to, I watch Democracy Now! Every day, their short news bulletin. I don't know how many of you do, but I'd highly recommend it. It's one of the few must-watch pieces of news journalism well, that exists as far as I'm concerned. I'm certainly in the English language speaking world. And today there were reports from California in the US of unprecedented wildfires. So unprecedented, we keep hearing about how far things are unprecedented at the moment. COVID was unprecedented, we are told. And in many ways that's true. And likewise, the scale and impact and harm that wildfires are causing in California at the moment is on a scale that we've never seen before. And that, I guess, by definition, makes them unprecedented. However, we should be careful of either assuming that they're inevitable and therefore denying our own agency in terms of pushing back against these harms. And that's something I hope we'll get to discuss collectively, as well as I'll say a bit about it in the second bit of this introduction. But also we should bear in mind that there are lots of people who've been warning us that these so-called unprecedented events and occurrences were likely to happen. So threats of pandemics have been trailed by epidemiologists and others, and likewise the threats of climate breakdown have been long mentioned. And in the case of the California wildfires, there's this weird perverse coming together of both the prison industrial complex, the pandemic, and climate breakdown itself. So I don't know how many of you know, but often what's the state of California will employ at a very, very low wage, so far below what would be classed as a living wage. I think it's about $1 a day, perhaps. Someone else might have more knowledge of this, but they employ prison laborers to fight the fires. And these people often through the state of their circumstances of being incarcerated, don't have a great deal of agency in deciding whether or not they want to pursue this form of work. But at the moment, because of COVID, and because COVID has been allowed to threaten the harm, just to jeopardize people who live in prisons and their lives, the state of California has not been able to draw on as much of the prison labor that it would usually be able to from prisons because of COVID outbreaks. And I just thought that was a quite a telling and also perverse coming together of both the prison industrial complex, the pandemic, and climate breakdown. It's not, you know, I mean, maybe that's something to mull over and think about when we come back to the discussion in a moment. But all that is just to say that at the moment we are living in this unprecedented situation. So in the Caribbean, for instance, it's hurricane season, and every year that hurricane season strikes, I kind of hold my breath. I have family who live in St. Kitts and Nevis, a small island state of about 50,000 people, so very tiny. But yeah, populated with people who have lives and livelihoods and who are directly at risk when hurricanes pass over the region. And many of you will have heard of the names of some of the recent hurricanes that have struck the Caribbean region. So there's Hurricane Sandy, which also hit the States, Matthew, Hurricane Erica, Irma, Maria, and Dorian. And indeed, again, what the research is telling us is that although each one of these hurricanes is unprecedented in its scale and its impact, this the increasing they're going to become less unprecedented. Does that mean they're going to become precedented? There will be a precedent for them, in that that's what the destabilization of the climate system means. It means less predictable, more severe, more extreme storms. So at the moment there are, you know, 70 mile an hour winds off the coast of the UK, for instance. There have been destructive cyclones across the Pacific region. I mean, you can look to almost any region of the world and you will see so-called unprecedented outcomes. The hottest temperature ever recorded likely was recorded probably in Death Valley last week for 54 degrees C, I believe, or was it 45? I'm never one for those details. But the point remains that we are in a time of increasingly frequent unprecedented climate effects. And what that means for people, particularly those such as those who live in the Caribbean, who are on the front lines of climate breakdown, is that they're disproportionately affected. And there are a number of reasons why they're disproportionately affected. And those have to do with the ways in which we organize our societies and the kinds of forms of politics that we've pursued, the economic development models, and as we'll go on to discuss, the ways in which we've chosen to view security and view whose responsibility it is to do the business of securing life or not securing life, as the case may be, and what institutions and military military organizations and formations have arisen in order to facilitate the model of securitization that's become very prevalent in the contemporary world. So I think, yeah, it's really important to start with this point that the climate crisis, although it has geophysical effects, is actually the product of those geophysical effects, but it's all those geophysical effects themselves are the product of the ways in which we've organized our societies and economies. So most of you, if not everyone, I'm sure, would know that it's the release of carbon emissions and other greenhouse gases that is leading to what scientists call the greenhouse effect, the warming of the atmosphere, which is leading to rise in temperatures. And even subtle rises in temperatures globally can have a hugely destabilizing impact upon the current climate that we've grown that humans have evolved under and grown to rely upon, and unfortunately, despite what we might like to think about the unlimited reach and capacities of human ingenuity, humans aren't particularly well prepared to cope with even minor changes in the climate system, and we're seeing far more than minor changes. As I mentioned, we're seeing unprecedented changes. And it's, if we go back to the question of social organization and we think about these harms of climate breakdown being linked to how we organize our societies, we can start to understand that it's not a coincidence that the people who are particularly vulnerable to the impacts of climate breakdown are people who live in the global majority world, so often what's called the global south, and they are predominantly people of global majority or people of color. There's a direct correlation between that fact and the fact that climate breakdown isn't being responded to as much of an urgency as it should be. And that's partly because the wealth and resources and decision-making power under the current kind of global order are concentrated in the global north. And yet the harms of climate breakdown, although they are spread around the global north as well, they're much more existential forms of harm in the global south. And it's for this reason that we've seen governments and others prevaricate in terms of introducing the kinds of policy and practice that we would need to see to be able to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and to shift economies away from really harmful forms of social organization towards those that would preserve and protect life. And I think, again, that's something that I would like you to hold in your minds, this question of whose lives get protected, whether that's in terms of climate breakdown or in terms of the role of the military, because I think it's key to trying to understand how these topics are connected. And so climate justice activists have pushed for a shift in terms of how we understand what it means to live in a society and what kind of society we should aspire to. Climate justice activists would point out that deeply unequal societies are ill-equipped to deal with these climate breakdowns. So the fact that you have Haiti, for instance, which is one of the poorest countries, not the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, based in the Caribbean and disproportionately exposed to earthquakes and hurricanes, is partly because Haiti doesn't have the resources that it needs, for instance, to build hurricane-resilient buildings or earthquake-resilient buildings. That's not to say that certain parts of the world are going to become less inhabitable. They certainly are. But if we had a better, more equal distribution of wealth and resources, we would be able to secure the lives of those people who are currently on the front lines of climate breakdown. And if we had a more humane system of distribution with regards to food, for instance, people might not be forced to flee their livelihoods, their homes, in pursuit of food and of, for instance, arable growing land. And that's something we've seen across different parts of the world. Many of you, I'm sure, are aware of research that was carried out in Syria that identified droughts, and unprecedented droughts, again, are a feature of climate breakdown, as being a contributing factor to destabilizing the internal population of Syria and leading people who had previously relied upon farming for their livelihoods to having to move to cities to seek work, and that being a contributing factor in the conflict that unfolded there. And it's, I guess, maybe at this point I'll go on to address the question of militarization, and I think there are, well, hopefully the readings that I've selected that focus more directly on militarization do a rich job of pointing out many of the ways in which we might connect the story of climate injustice or the pursuit of climate justice that I've just mentioned to that of sort of militarization. But I'll just pick up on identify three levels in which we might want to turn our attention to when thinking about that relationship. And there are lots of others as well. I mean, we might think about the disproportionate impacts of military violence on formerly or presently colonized people, and the ways in which racism has been used to underpin military action. And we could connect that to the dehumanization that takes place, whereby people are able to kind of forget about and disregard the impacts of climate breakdown on people of color globally. But that's not where I want to start. Where I want to start is first in terms of this quite a technical but very significant point that's been made by a number of researchers. And that's about the role of emissions in the military sector. So as I mentioned previously, greenhouse gas emissions are what contribute to climate breakdown. It's well documented that these need to be reduced. And so what about if we pay attention to the role of the military? Well, those who have paid attention to the role of the military have pointed out that it's one of the US military, for instance, is one of the largest institutional emitters of greenhouse gases. But the military sector is kind of exempt under the governmental frameworks that have arisen to try and address climate breakdown. So that's quite an important kind of first step. We've got this technical obstacle that we need to overcome, which is that the military sector is a significant contributor to climate emissions. But I think we can go further than that, and we can interrogate how it is that the military sector is responding to climate breakdown in order to address a second level, if you like, of the relationship between the two. And this would be, again, it's covered really well by some of the authors who I mentioned, one of whom is on this call and some of you will be speaking to shortly. And that's the way in which the military sector is actually taking climate breakdown incredibly seriously, considering it's one of the biggest emitters. And I don't mean that in terms of seriously in the way that we might want it to take climate breakdown. We might want the military to look at itself and say, hang on, there's all this expenditure, all these resources going into developing new military technologies, expanding overseas bases, and so on. And a consequence of that is disproportionate emissions. Let's reduce our emissions, let's reduce the spend. No, that's not how they're taking climate breakdown seriously. again, there's a perversity to the way in which they are taking climate breakdown more seriously. So whilst we have the kind of denier in chief in the White House, Donald Trump, who's expressed countless times kind of a denial or skepticism around climate science, his Pentagon is taking the threat of climate breakdown very seriously in terms of the militarization of the American border, the erecting of fences along the border, the offshoring and outsourcing, if you like, of migrant detention, and also efforts to secure increasingly scarce resources abroad. So we know from the history of the conflict, the war in Iraq, that part of the significant part of the motivation for that war was trying to secure access to oil. And as climate breakdown unfolds, we're also seeing threats to water supplies. And so military bodies across the world are kind of scrambling to try and pursue, to secure rather, access to water. In addition, there's lots of talk about green transitions and Green New Deals, which on the one hand, I'm incredibly supportive of, depending on the version of Green New Deal or green transition that's being advocated. But there are some versions of a green transition which involve simply substituting polluting greenhouse gases for another technology, so say solar or wind. Now, I'm not against that per se. However, colleagues such as those at the London Mining Network and War on Want have identified the fact that you can't simply substitute the scale of energy consumption and generation that we currently see from greenhouse gases to renewables. That won't address the fundamental harms that are also a consequence of climate breakdown. So we see the military being involved in attempts to secure the rare earth minerals that are essential for the green transition. So these rare earth minerals are involved in conflict in Central Africa, for instance. And the solar infrastructure, the electrification infrastructure, all of the sort of physical infrastructure that's required for versions of a green transition, where you simply say we're gonna produce the same amount of energy, but instead of using non-renewables, we're gonna use renewables. Often that will fuel conflict, and it will feed into it will feed into processes of militarization around the world. So there's this way in which military bodies and governments, through their military, are actually taking the climate crisis very seriously, just not in the way that they should. So rather than thinking about cutting emissions, cutting military expenditure, instead they're thinking, well, there's a growing role for the military because there's not only resources that need to be secured, but there's also a likelihood of there being increasing conflict because of the scarcity of resources. And the case of Syria that I mentioned earlier is one example. But we could look to the tragic case of the people who have the young boy who was fleeing Sudan and whose body washed up on the shores of Calais or northern France yesterday. Calls for the British Navy are being made to try and stop people who are kind of fleeing situations that are increasingly untenable in terms of their livability. So that's all connected to climate breakdown, and we're likely to see an increase in the number of people who will have to flee because we're not doing what we have to do to address and mitigate the climate crisis. People will have to move, and yet the reception that they receive is not one of a kind of welcoming and encouraging support. It's one of how can we use the military and how can we militarize our borders to stop these people from coming. And then the third level, I'm timing myself and I see I'm approaching the 20-minute cutoff, but I'm hoping that Sianna will give me will permit me a little bit of leeway. The third level is to think about resistance. And I feel like this is the most optimistic and hopeful and perhaps in some ways the most important level in which to think about the relationship between climate injustice or justice and militarization. And I think there's lots of ways to think about it. And I think going into the breakout groups, perhaps this will be one of the things that we can concentrate on. But I think that one thing that I've noticed coming from the climate justice movement has been the ways in which the tactics of, say, the anti-war and peace movements have been deployed and borrowed by the climate justice movement as well. And I'm thinking here of perhaps forms of direct action that were used to, say, ground military planes, locking on to pieces of equipment so that they can't be exported to be used in murder and oppression. The same techniques are used by climate justice activists to prevent, for instance, deportation flights of migrants who are disproportionately being impacted by climate breakdown, or to stop put out of commission really harmful infrastructure that's used to further the climate crisis through generating emissions. So I think there's a lot of fruitful ground for thinking about how, when we're resisting to one or other of these two prongs of all these two issues, we can actually be resisting to the same thing. And I think one thing that I identified when I was part of the climate and environmental movement was a slightly concerning tendency to not see the connections between climate breakdown and other forms of harm. So, for instance, the role of the military globally, or inequality. And I think that the most encouraging responses to climate breakdown that I've seen have been precisely those that do link it up to the fight against militarization, the fights for other forms of justice, whether that's migration justice and solidarity, or trade justice, or attempts to repair some of the harms of historic and present colonialism. And so I think when we're thinking about the connections between climate justice and climate breakdown, we also want to think about how we can connect the struggles against both. So the struggle against injustice and the struggle against militarization.